I wanted to bring to your remembrance this day one thing concerning the revelation of truth, concerning the high and the lofty one, the God that inhabits eternity, whose name is holy, the one who is from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. The scripture reveals of him, he is faithful that promised. See, the scripture reveals these things about God, not only for this matter of a compilation of information and data concerning God, but rather to acknowledge that he himself is a source of divine power, a God who has purposed and a God who fulfills. He is faithful unto doing these very things. Now, to those who are given to know the only true God, who mix this revelation of knowledge of God with their faith, there comes benefits from that. Benefits of understanding God, of knowing God himself, and knowing that God has purposed an eternal purpose in Christ Jesus. And to know that his eternal salvation is that which comes from Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, this matter of God being faithful, he was accomplishing and doing things even before we knew it. See, he had determined and purposed to make a covenant, a new covenant, a covenant of blessing, a covenant of something that he would do which no man in his own strength could do. He said he would put his laws into their hearts. And in their minds will he write them. And their sins, he said, and iniquities will I remember no more. And reasoning on this, the apostle would reason that where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Now see, in knowing this, and partaking and receiving this working that God has done in Christ, there are benefits. Benefits the which the scripture reveals. That we now have boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. See? He is faithful that promised. And he goes on to say there's more benefits. That now we have a high priest over the house of God, according to promise. A high priest was promised that he would be the one that would be there forever. Amen. After the order of Melchizedek. Amen. And because of that promise and because of that fulfillment, you are able to draw near to God. Amen. In full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Amen. And there's benefits that continue on. A benefit of strengthening for you to continue on, in order that you would hold fast the profession of your faith without wavering. And the apostle encourages the brethren in this very truth of God. He is faithful that promised. Amen. See, from the earliest times, God would be about instructing and teaching his people about himself. To get this knowledge of himself ingrained into their very thoughts, into their very minds, into their very hearts. To know him, that he is the God that works according to promise, and that he is the God that is faithful to fulfill that which he has promised. Amen. And this truth about God continues on and on, for he changeth not. The scripture reveals in Joshua 23, when Joshua waxed old and was stricken in age, having disposed of these enemies in the land by the hand of God, and the people of God had rested in peace for a long time. See, Joshua reminded the people of what really had occurred there, that it was God that brought this all to pass. He said, not one thing hath failed of all the good things which the Lord your God spake concerning you. All are come to pass unto you, and not one thing hath failed thereof. See, the manner of God's working, he'll raise up men of understanding. He will give men understanding to know that know God and be able to declare when things happen that this is the Lord's doing, to minister unto God's people of this truth concerning God. He is faithful that promised. After the seven-year building project of the temple was completed, and the glory of the Lord had filled the house of the Lord, on that day, King Solomon would speak with all the congregation of Israel who were standing before him. He spoke concerning what they were seeing in the temple. While standing in this exceeding magnificent structure, the king did not glory in his own might before God's people. He didn't even give a word of suggestion that what was accomplished here was by his might. He did neither glory in the worldly riches that adorned this magnificent place from top to bottom, from east to west, and from north to south. Nor did he glory in his wisdom that oversaw the project from start to finish. Instead, he gloried in his knowledge and understanding of God. See, in the very midst of this temple, this beautiful place that was created and built, Solomon would reveal that it was God who brought this all to pass. And he did it according to promise. The promise that God had spoken to Moses, and also a promise that he had spoken to his father David. A promise concerning an inheritance, a chosen land to dwell in, a time of peace to rest in. And there would not fail a man to sit on the throne of Israel. See, Solomon was given this understanding by God to see that what had been fulfilled at that time was according to God's promise. What had happened had not occurred because of their good fortune or by the will of man, but of God. His message to God's people was that God was faithful to fulfill what he had promised. Amen. And he wanted the people of God to have this knowledge and understanding of God as well. So he proclaimed this truth unto them. He declared this truth unto God's people. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, which spake with his mouth unto David my father, and hath with his hand fulfilled it. And again he said, the Lord hath performed his word that he spake, as the Lord promised. And finally, as the great congregation of the people stood together, listening to the king speak, one more glorious revelation of God declared, blessed be the Lord that hath given rest unto his people Israel according to all he had promised. There hath not failed one word of all his good promise, which he promised by the hand of Moses, his servant. Amen. Behold our God. Amen. Yea, I have spoken it. Yea, I will also bring it to pass. Amen. This is our God. And from these earliest times, see, he was teaching and instructing his people concerning himself. But it's the gospel that opens up the fullness with clarity of that exceeding great promise. See, when he spoke about these things, about lands and places for the inheritance of his people, see, this was only in a seed form. He would open up this promise to the exceeding greatness of what he was speaking about in the beginning. The fullness, he would speak about the fullness. The gospel would reveal the fullness of the promise, which has no bounds in time or place in the earth. The gospel would reveal that the fullness is in that world which is to come and in the ages to come. And this is very reasonable. He is the everlasting God. And so would God plant the fullness of his promise in a place where it's going to be burnt away? See, it's not reasonable that God would do such a thing. He would not put his promise, anchor his promise, in a place that will pass away with them. And so the gospel declares in 1 John 2:25, this is the promise that he, God, hath promised us, even eternal life. See, eternal life is the sum and the substance of the promise God has promised us, beginning with that which he began to speak in the beginning, now being opened up unto fullness, eternal life. And the gospel not only declares the fullness of the promise, but it also declares that you have it now. By faith in God's beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, John would say in chapter 5, verse 12, for he that hath the Son hath the life. See, this is, you have it now. That's the good news of the gospel. He's declaring that the promise, see, God was faithful that promised. But see, this promise, as we were saying, has a fullness attached to it. A fullness that still is yet to come. And that fullness is going to be obtained in that world. Not this one. But now you have the first fruits of it. Now, the gospel continues to talk about the preciousness of this promise, the promise of eternal life. It's bestowed upon those who had once been banished from his presence because of sin. But now, because of what Jesus accomplished, and by faith in him, the obtainment, see, of the first fruits of that promise is ours. And all that goes along with it, see, this, the opening up of this promise is that large room that we've come into. See, this matter of being banished, and now that God has brought you into his house, that you may dwell in that house all the days of your life. Something has been changed, and God has accomplished it. There's been an effectual change by God for you and in you. A work that has eternal significance. A work that now declares that you are accepted by God in the Beloved, in Christ Jesus. And continues to speak about that acceptance, that you should partake of it, enter into it. How so? boldly coming to the throne of grace, that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in your time of need. You have it. See, in Christ Jesus, he that hath the Son hath life. And there's still more. See, more to be declared by the gospel. The gospel declares there's still better things to come. Better things. Better things for you to partake of. See, but they are revealed to be for the world to come and for the ages to come. These are things that you're going to partake of in full there. Amen. When there shall be no more tears, where there shall be no more death, where there shall be no more sorrow, no more crying, and no more pain. The promise of a new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness, with a promise that there shall in no wise enter into it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie.
Amen.
You can count on that. Because God has promised it, and he's faithful, that's promised. There's more things to be known here that the gospel will reveal unto us, even though we have the first fruits of it. The Apostle Paul would reveal the truth of our sojourn here in this time, in this present evil world, concerning its full reception. He said this in Philippians 3, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended in Christ Jesus. He's opening up this truth now, and we want to reason on this truth for the fullness. See, the objective is the fullness of the promise, the obtainment of it. And so as Paul is declaring unto us, we want to reason what he's talking about here. It means this fullness of the promise and obtainment is something that you're going to have to fight for in order to lay hold of its fullness. It means that what we have now must be kept. Because the gospel reveals we have an adversary who's going to try to take it from you. But the gospel tells us, see, God has made provisions for us to keep it. We want to have that resolve like the psalmist who says, my soul followeth hard after thee. This is the kind of people we want to be known for in the heavenly places. We follow hard after the Lord. We follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth.
Amen.
And then God announces the provision to accomplish that. He says, thy right hand upholdeth me. It's God that's holding you in the fight. Be confident of this very thing, for he is faithful that promised. See, we also it's revealed to us that the following hard after the Lord does come at a price.
Amen.
To those who are following hard after the Lord, you will encounter trials. And you will encounter testings. You will encounter times of being cast down and times of persecution.
Yes.
Even times of great tribulation. This is the cost of following the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. But see, know this as well. God is faithful to equip us under the full obtainment of that promise. See, again, know that God is upholding you in the fight, in the following hard. This is, behold our God. He is faithful to strengthen us, to keep that which is given unto us, and to overcome all adversaries unto the possession of the fullness of the promise. Now, these things are being ministered through the gospel, that you would indeed enter in and partake of that which God has desired to give unto you. So be persuaded. Be persuaded of the truth of the revelation of who God is. He is faithful that promised. He's faithful to fulfill his promises. Is God's very nature. It's his character. He is faithful. And he cannot deny himself. So through the gospel, he continues to minister better promises. See, there are better things still to come. To increase your trust and your faith in God. That what he's promised, he is also able to perform. Amen. So, with this first fruit possession in hand, so to speak, and with these better things still yet to come, there's something else you're going to have to know here. The fight is going to become intensified. And the running of the race is going to require more endurance to finish. Because of the many hindrances along the way. But if you were wearied when you were running with the footmen, how should you contend then with the horses? And the time of the horses has come. We need to be equipped with better things to endure to the end. And it will not come by looking to the physical land of Israel that Joshua possessed. Or will not look at the, will not come, that strength will not come by looking at the remains of the temple that Solomon built. These are not sufficient resources to lay hold of eternal life. Our strength to fight the good fight of faith and lay hold of the promise of eternal light will only come by looking unto Jesus. The man, Christ Jesus, in God's faithfulness to perform what he had promised to a man. God performed these promises to the man, Christ Jesus. Amen. Now, in seeing God's faithfulness according to the promises he made to his beloved son, I say again to the man, Christ Jesus. See, this is where your strength comes from. Because the gospel reveals other things about your being joined to the Lord Jesus. It's of God that you are in Christ Jesus. Amen. And that all the promises of God are in him, yea, and in him, amen. Amen. And in view of these things, what the gospel is making known, you are being equipped to run the race set before you. So the exhortation is, don't lose sight of him. For in him, in Christ, you are armed with truth. In him, Christ Jesus, you're strengthened to run and to fight and leap over a wall if need be, to overcome and to obtain. Now, the gospel is revealing that Christ Jesus himself is the affirmation of this truth. And that in the days of his flesh, he lived in the prospect of the fulfillment of the promise that God made unto him. There are many of these promises recorded in the scriptures for us to reveal the truth that God is faithful that promised. The Apostle Paul summed it up this way, talking about the days of Jesus' living in the days of his flesh. He says, who for the joy set before him. Who set that joy before him? It was God, his Father, had spoken promises unto him. And these promises were powerful, and they were eternal and everlasting, and effected in him in order that he would endure the cross, despising the shame. The gospel declares to these glad tidings of good things that the God who promised is faithful to perform. For the verse continues then, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down. See? He is set down by the faithful God at the right hand of the throne of God, according to the promise he made unto him. One of the promises recorded for us from Psalm 89, promise the Father made to the Son. He says, I will make him my firstborn higher than the kings of the earth. Now, this promise was sounded out by God, and it wasn't done in a corner of heaven. It was done for the angels to hear it, and for the principalities and powers to hear it, that this is something God promised he was going to do. It was all declared for all that heard it to know what God would be working unto fulfillment. And so this is something that we want to know about God. If you want to know what God is going to do, look to what he's promised. He is faithful that promised. And this is the very thing that God is going to do unto Jesus. And the gospel is that which declares the truth of God's faithfulness to him. After Jesus has finished his work on the earth, laying down his life in atonement for many, he was raised from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and the gospel reveals the truth of God's faithfulness unto his beloved Son, that I will make him higher than the kings of the earth. The gospel declares that God set him down his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet. See, I will make him higher than the kings of the earth. God has exalted Jesus and has given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Behold the faithfulness of God. He is faithful that promised. Now these are the very foundations of our faith, that which strengthen us to endure, to carry on, to run, to fight. But how then does that transfer unto us individually and as a people? Here again, the promise that God made to the Son. I will make him my firstborn. And it's through Moses and the prophets that God begins to teach about the preeminence of the firstborn. The firstborn, see, is the one who is the heir. He's the strength of the Father. He is the one to be honored. He is the preeminent one, the firstborn. And the gospel is that which opens up the glory of the promise to us who believe in Jesus, because he is the firstborn from the dead. He is God's firstborn. He's the firstborn of every creature. All this is announcing as firstborn, Jesus has the preeminence in all things. See, God promised this, and he worked it out. He was faithful to accomplish that which he promised to the Son. He is the heir of all things, and he's honored above all. But unto our edification and our hope in the promise, the gospel also reveals that he's the firstborn among many brethren. See, in this instance, firstborn speaks of there's many more to follow. Many more. More than the sands of the seashore. More than the stars in the heavens. And it was the Apostle John, see, who was given to see that this God is faithful that promised. When he was on the Isle of Patmos, he saw this great multitude before the throne and before the Lamb. A great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and peoples and tongues. See, the promise of God was recorded in the Psalms But the gospel declares in truth, he is faithful that promised.
Amen.
So it's to the benefit and help of all the people of God to continue to declare Jesus Christ high and lifted up.
Yes.
And the promise, see, that promise of many more brethren coming, see, is sufficient, a sufficient strengthening for us to continue in the race set before us, to fight that good fight of faith and lay hold of eternal life. Because the fullness is nigh at hand, brethren. The fullness of the reception of the promise is nigh, very close.
Amen.
Now these things, again, are a working of God, a showing forth of his faithfulness. For those who are engaged in this fight of faith, see, there's going to be a message of hope and of strength. And you look unto Jesus for that. Remember in the days of his flesh, when he was sojourning in the land, it is written of the waters that he would have to pass through, of being despised and rejected of the very ones he came to save. There were times of him having to pass through the rivers of sorrow and grief, whose very life was defined by suffering. Seeing firsthand of the devastation that sin had wrought on his creation. And then there came the time when he would have to pass through the fire of being made sin for us who knew no sin. And yet he endured the cross by the promise of his heavenly Father, who said unto him, "Fear not, for I am with thee.
Amen.
Yea, I will hold thine hand, and I will keep thee."
Amen.
And even though, while Jesus hung on the cross, by all outward appearances, he was alone, for his disciples had been scattered, every one to his own, thereby leaving him alone, yet, Jesus affirmed, yet, I am not alone because my Father is with me. For the Lord God will help me. That was his strength in going to the cross. Jesus endured by the promise of the Father and being persuaded that what he had promised, he was able to perform. And perform it, he did. On that third day. On that third day when the Son rose from the dead, never to die again. For God had made a promise to his Son to do this very thing. The Father had made this promise to him, and it was affirmed by the Apostle Peter on the day of Pentecost. He said, "Thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption." This is the promise the Father made to his Son. And in view, see, in view of this promise, in the knowing of his Father that's faithful, Jesus would declare, "My heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh shall also rest in hope," rest in the hope of the promise that he would be raised from the dead. These are the things he was reckoning on about his God and his Father. He would be raised, he says, in order to partake of the path of life, of a new life. He wasn't going back to the carpenter's shop in Jerusalem. He wasn't raised to be the head of the Sanhedrin. He was raised to be the high priest of God. He was raised to be set upon the holy hill of Zion as king. He was raised to be the mediator of the New Testament. He was raised to intercede for the people of God. He was raised to feed and nurture the people of God. He was raised to build his church, the paths of life, the new life, and to partake of the fullness of joy of being in God's presence in the partakement of the pleasures forevermore that are at his right hand. And on that third day, see, on that third day, God fulfilled that promise unto him. Promise when he raised from the dead with great power and glory. It was something that he had prophesied of that God was going to do. This was from Micah, the prophet Micah, who declared, "The breaker is come up. He's come up. The shout of triumph and overcoming that which held men captive from the beginning, that being sin and death and the grave." The revealing of the destruction of the one who had the power of death, that is the devil. The breaker, the man, Christ Jesus, has broken up from the dead, amen, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it, for in him was no sin. Amen. There's good news for us in this announcement of the breaker. You want to hear this as well, because there's a them and a they in it as well. There's a them and a they associated with the breaker coming up. The breaker is come up before them, or ahead of them, or the first one to come up. He's the first begotten of the dead. So that means in that case, too, there's more coming with him. When he's breaking out, he's bringing many with him. And he says they have broken up as well. It's because the breaker has broken out of the prison. And he has opened this door, which no man can shut. And them that sit in darkness, they've been brought out of the prison house, just as the Father promised he would. See, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is a powerful testimony to all that believe that God is faithful that promised. And we need to continue to look unto Jesus. And to look into that where God has brought him according to promise. He said to John on the Isle of Patmos, he says, "I am he that liveth and was dead. But behold, I am alive forevermore." See, he was saying this to John, the apostle, as he walked through the midst of the churches. See, he knew his churches were undergoing persecution, trial and testings, and even having to deal with sin in the camp. And he was going to give them a word. See, he was going to give them a word of strengthening. He says, "John, you write these things down in a book. You tell them what you saw, that I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of hell and of death." That would be a strengthening to the people of God to overcome that which what they were having to endure. This is a glorious announcement, too, about his resurrection from the dead concerning us. And again, the gospel is that which declares it unto us. He announced this to the beloved of God, the called to be saints in Rome. This is what he said in Romans 6:4. He said, "Like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life." Hear that announcement. That same divine power that raised Jesus from the dead has raised up as well. He's raised us up who were dead in trespasses and sins. He raised us up from sin and death unto eternal life. This is not only good doctrine, it's a glorious reality. For having partaken of the reality of Romans 6:3, that so many of us that were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death, these all are the partakers of the reality of verse 4. That you were, as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in the newness of life. And the apostle would continue to open up more. See, this is the manner of the kingdom. There's more to be partaken of, more to be seen, more to be heard, more to be walked in, more to be lived in. And he says, if you be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, he bringing you right back to looking unto Jesus, reckoning on what God did with Jesus, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, hath no more death, for death hath no more dominion over him. Well, you've been put into Christ for the salvation that is in him. And so, we want to reckon. We want to reckon on these things as the apostles do. Now, we reckon that we reckon ourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Alive unto that day of fulfillment. See, we're a people that are alive, but we're waiting for our change to come. When this mortal body puts on immortality, when the corruptible puts on incorruptible. We are alive and unto the anticipation of the reception of the fullness of the promise, to wit, the redemption of our body. See, we are alive looking for that glorious appearing of the great God and of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the gospel announces, for when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Amen. Brethren, he is faithful that promised.